Hi friends, I'm John Kempf, hosting this podcast. I'm passionate about developing regenerative agriculture systems that improve soil health, produce crops that are completely resistant to diseases and insects, and produce fruit of such an exceptional quality that we can have a legitimate conversation about growing food as medicine. I've discovered that there are many people with incredible knowledge and information about soil and plant systems and how to develop regenerative agriculture systems. However, much of this knowledge and this information is scattered. It's found all over the place. Some of it has been published in peer-reviewed publications, but there are many incredible stories and a lot of knowledge that has not been published and that hasn't been shared with many people. I started Advancing Eco-Agriculture in 2006 to bring this knowledge together in a more coherent fashion and incorporate it into products and growing systems that growers can easily put into practice. It's my personal mission to have these regenerative agricultural systems become adopted globally and become the mainstream, the status quo, against which all other growing systems are compared. To help achieve this goal, I want to share the knowledge that we have learned in the last decade and make it available to everyone. While we have developed products at AEA that embody the principles of regenerative agriculture systems and make them easier for growers to apply, this knowledge and these principles can be applied anywhere, and when they are applied properly, they will always increase farm profitability and resilience to climate stress. If you have any questions, suggestions, comments, or ideas, topics that you would like for me to discuss, please connect on LinkedIn or on Twitter, where my username is at visionbuilder7, or you can also email me at john@johnkempf.com. I would very much like to hear from you and to hear your feedback. Be sure to subscribe to this podcast, and thank you very much for listening. Enjoy the show.
Greetings, friends, and welcome to the Regenerative Agriculture Podcast. On this podcast, we explore the science and the practical application of regenerative agriculture ecosystems, how to regenerate soil health, crop health and quality, and increase farm profitability. Our goal is to give you clear, easy to understand, and actionable information that you can implement on your operation right away. On this episode, I'm very excited to welcome Tom Dykstra to our show. Tom is a good friend of mine and has done some extraordinary work in the area of entomology and plant insect communication systems that I'm very excited to discuss and to also hear your thoughts and feedback on. Tom, welcome to the show. We're very excited to have you here.
Happy to be here, John. Ready to divulge and talk. And thank you so much for the invitation. And I hope that this is productive for you and for the listeners as well.
Tom, you've done some fascinating research over the years, both of your own and also some with your mentor, Philip Callahan. What are some of your most memorable moments that led you to where you are today?
Some of the most memorable moments for me were probably getting fired at the University of Florida, which led me to study under Phil Callahan. So that would probably rank near the top. Had that not happened, I certainly would not have been on the path that I am right now. So once that path began, and I was looking at the time with flea larvae, I was playing with them, a seemingly uninteresting insect, or so I thought at the time, that led into my PhD project and allowed me to explore the world of insect bioelectromagnetics, which then opened up a whole new world to me that I had never been exposed to, either in academia or very little in the literature and even less in books. So this has been an exciting journey for me. The reason why is because it's a new field, and the only ones I know who are even remotely in the field are in the military. So therefore, from academia, it's kind of quiet on this front, but I do enjoy what I'm doing here, and I'm happy that I had a chance to explore this fascinating area of insect bioelectromagnetics.
Insect bioelectromagnetics sounds fascinating. Can you describe for us what that is? What are you actually working on?
Not a clue. I couldn't tell you anything. I'm just making up the word. The word has to do with the electromagnetic waves and how they are influenced by organisms, thus the name bio. So electromagnetic simply be involved in the pure waves, and bioelectromagnetics would be how these waves influence life. Now, these waves could be external to the organism, but let's say environmental, or they could be internal, so that you would have communication going on within the organism as to what information needs to pass from one organ to another, or simply one part of the body to another, or in some cases to actually amplify the message to make it more easily discernible to an insect or even any other animal. So the bioelectromagnetic field is relatively large because they have a journal out, and there are many journal articles you can find, but the field specifically of insect bioelectromagnetics is not. That is a much smaller field. So for those who are involved in the insect side of it, you can see that they're few and far between. But the field itself is relatively small, which I guess gives me a certain amount of anonymity, and which is required because I do run a research laboratory, and we are not allowed to publish. And so all of the research that we do, most of the research that we do, is kind of kept under wraps. And we have had some absolutely wonderful discoveries that I really hope that someday I will be able to divulge to the public.
When you speak of insect bioelectromagnetics, what is the impact or the potential impact of your work on agriculture, and what might farmers be able to apply in the future?
That's a difficult question, because when you get involved in the pure bioelectromagnetics, you're looking at these fields that really are not measurable, and for the most part should not be measurable, because the farmer is not going to be out there with the type of equipment in order to measure these fields. So in a direct sense, there would be very little impact. In the more general sense, there is a much larger impact that is simply not something that most people are aware of, and that is the energy and how it is acquired by plants. So photosynthesis is certainly a well-known phenomenon that everyone is familiar with. Find in textbook after textbook, whether it be in biology or plant physiology. And so that's kind of a starting point in the field of bioelectromagnetics, is the agriculture. If you can optimize photosynthesis, once you optimize photosynthesis, and which has that electromagnetic component, biochemicals and organic chemistry and others as well, but once you optimize that, you then optimize BRICS level, because the relationship between photosynthesis and BRICS is about as linear as you can get. I mean, the more a plant photosynthesizes, the higher the BRICS reading is, and the higher the BRICS reading is, the healthier the plant. And when you have a healthy plant, this is where you bring it into agriculture, and it becomes, you know, very important to a farmer. Because when you're raising healthy plants, you don't have to bring in, for example, all of the pesticides that are being used today, whether it be herbicides, insecticides, fungicides, nematicides. It doesn't matter what side you're using. They're all doing the job of killing life, and you're trying to, as a farmer, what you're trying to do is you're trying to augment life, and this augmentation can take many different forms. So the sun and the energy that comes from it is certainly an obvious one. There are less obvious electromagnetic waves out there. The Schumann frequencies are relatively well known and have been studied by atmospheric sciences for a long time, also would have their influence too. And once you are surrounded by all these frequencies and be able to absorb the energy, or to use this as a communication piece, then you now have healthy plants, healthy crops growing in a very healthy environment. And so understanding that and ways to optimize the electromagnetic component is only going to benefit the farmers. So if I were giving a talk, and I've given a few talks on energy in agriculture to help them understand these fields and how to optimize them and how to prevent the farmer from getting in the way or putting up any blockages to these frequencies.
I would love to hear more about your thoughts regarding photosynthesis. I mean, photosynthesis is so foundational that when you drive you're able to increase photosynthesis, then you have all these other benefits of increasing carbon sequestration, improving plant health, disease, and insect resistance. This is something that we focus a lot of attention on and usually approach from a biochemistry perspective of thinking about how we can optimize photosynthesis. I have a couple of questions for you. One is, how much do you think it's possible to increase photosynthesis above what is common, perhaps, or normal, depending on how you chose to define that word? How much can it be increased? And looking at photosynthesis from a bioelectromagnetics perspective, what tools would you use to optimize it and to increase it if possible?
Okay. Well, your first question, and I'll probably forget your second question as I'm describing the answer to the first, but how much can you increase it? You can increase it substantially. And the reason why I know that is because most of the crops that I've had a chance to take a look at are between 4 and 8 bricks. Now, once you get up to roughly right around 12, all serious insect damage stops. And once you get up to about 14, you have a genuinely healthy plant that is producing healthy food that, you know, can be consumed by a human being and will lead to a long life. But because we are so far below what we consider to be, let's say, optimal would be 14 and above. 12 is kind of like the minimum so that you don't get the insect damage. But because we're right now between 4 and 8, I can tell you unequivocally that we can increase photosynthesis considerably simply because we are... We have many plants right now which are suffering in the sense that they're not working up to their potential. And so because they're not working up to the potential, I know that we absolutely, I mean, even getting to 9, which is still not a healthy plant, is an improvement over a lot of the plants which I've had a chance to look at, whether it be plants out in someone's backyard or whether it be crop plants out on a farmer's field. They're all dealing with very low bricks, and therefore the plants are compromised. And so really the only way you can only go is up, because the only once you go down, plants die, and there's really nothing which can save them at that point. So you do have a range, and if you want to maintain a plant at a very low bricks, let's say 1 or 2, you have to feed it every day. There's no way around it. So anyone who has ever played the game of golf has walked on plants that are running about 1 or 2. And if you go even one day without feeding that grass under your feet, it will suffer considerably because they have very little photosynthetic part above the ground. Their root system has been absolutely compromised due to usually what is being applied. And so that's the extreme case where you can actually, in a very artificial way, keep a plant going by continually feeding it. It's a force feeding operation. And the same thing goes with the crop plants. Now, the crop plants, the farmer is not out there feeding them on a daily basis, such as you would find on the golf course. That would be obviously the exception. But when you're dealing with a crop situation, the farmer is going to be feeding his crops. At the minimum, he's going to be doing it once or twice during the season, but probably more often than that, depending upon what type of plant it is, whether it's a perennial or not. And so it's a matter of getting the photosynthetic rate up. And this means certainly, as I kind of alluded to, is not putting up any of the blockages. Now, some of the blockages that I'm kind of alluding to that I discussed a little bit before are certainly and absolutely pesticides. The reason why this is so is because pesticides are killing all of the microbes in the soil, and the microbes can be selectively killed. So one herbicide is going to selectively kill certain microbes. An insecticide is going to kill a certain set of microbes as well. A fungicide will kill a certain set of microbes, and even a nematicide. We have nematicides down here in Florida. They're not as common in the rest of the country, but each one of these is doing its job to kill. Now, when these microbes are gone, they are no longer able to hold on to the energy that is in their body. And so you have now given up a massive energy source. And this is where the electromagnetics comes in, is that if you do not have those microbes in there, there is no energy in the soil. And so this sequestered energy, each microbe, just to give you an idea, is about 0.5 volt. If you take all of the energy found in a microbe, a little bacteria, it's about 0.5 volt. Now, this does not mean that, you know, there is this massive amount of energy that, you know, that if you stepped on some ground with millions of microbes, it would blow your foot off or it would catapult you into the air 15 feet. What this means is that this is clean, stored energy it's found in the membranes, it's found in chloroplasts, endoplasmic reticulum. Everything that is inside the cell has a nice, clean storage form of this energy, and that is then made available to the plant, either directly, because sometimes the plant can use the nutrients if the microbe dies, and microbes are dying all the time, and then some of the nutrients can be taken up because everything is bioavailable when a microbe dies. Or you can have a more indirect result when the microbe is actually releasing minerals to the plant. So these microbes can break down minerals far more efficiently than plants. And without these microbes, you're no longer able to get the minerals in. And these minerals are the constituents. These are the cofactors that are used to to keep photosynthesis going hot and heavy, so to speak. So without these minerals, photosynthesis suffers and we see lower bricks. And so the relationship, how everything seems to be kind of connected together through the microbes, the energy, because the plants want to put their roots into a high energy soil. And if it's been sterilized, they don't have that. And so you then become incumbent in order to feed the plant, to force feed the plant. And this is not the way plants were designed to live, is to be force fed on a regular basis. So to kind of answer your question, and I'm trying to tie as many things together as possible so that you can see the importance of energy, and it's not just about that which is above the ground, the leaves and photosynthesizing, but also getting those minerals from the soil so that you can assist photosynthesis going on in the leaves. They're all important and have a component in making sure that the energy system of plant are revved up and doing exactly what they're supposed to be doing. And we can easily measure this with a very simple measurement of bricks. There are many different ways of studying plant health. Bricks is by far the easiest thing to do if you're a farmer. There's really, if you're going to be doing something on your own, it's probably one of the easiest things to do. There are other more, you can send things out to a laboratory, you can get tissue analysis, you can play all types of complex games, and scientific laboratories can get involved, but if you need something that can be done right there on the spot, it will be bricks. And so, therefore, when talking to farmers, if you need to get them in that mentality to understand that there's an easy way to tell whether their plant is healthy, it will also have an impact on their crop, which, of course, has to deal with their yield and money in the long run.
One of the pieces that we have been using a lot, and one of the tools that we've been using a lot in lieu of the refractometer or brickometer, is a sap analysis, because it actually measures the actual measured sugar content. And the refractometer is a very useful and valuable tool, but the challenge that many growers have with using it regularly is just the variability and the inconsistency that can occur based on moisture and sunlight levels and et cetera, et cetera. So it's something that we do use, but we actually use a lot of sap analysis results as well to try to remove some of the variability. But I have a follow-up question to what you just described regarding photosynthesis. So summary, my summary of understanding what you described is essentially you are looking at plant growth from a biophysics perspective rather than from a biochemistry perspective. And you're saying that energy for plants doesn't just come from photosynthesis and sunlight. It actually comes from soil biology because of the voltage contained within microbial cells in the soil profile. And that if you really want to increase that, the first step is do no harm and stop killing them. Is that a summary of what you're describing?
I think that would be probably the most worthwhile summary in order to say yes. That would be one of the first steps to do, is to stop using the pesticides if we can help it. There are some individuals who will need to wean themselves off over the course of one, two, maybe even three seasons. But to be honest with you, I'm not sure if I would be an advocate of three seasons. I think that weaning yourself off of it should be done as soon as possible, certainly within a season if you need to. But there are ways in order to speed the process up, in order to get the soil healthy again so that you can start farming the way that God intended.
What are some of those ways of speeding up the process? I think that's the question that I'm really trying to get to, is obviously we can stop and discontinue, or kind of, as we suggest, earn the right to discontinue the use of these pesticides. But then what can we do to increase the energy flow in the soil profile?
Okay. Then what I usually ask a farmer is, for example, how many acres do you have? And let's just say they say 1,000. I have 1,000 acres. So I would say, all right, how much are you willing to give up? How much can you afford not to produce on? Now, sometimes they come back with, well, I can't afford anything. But when you really press them and get them to the point where you can say, how much can you afford to lose? They'll usually tell you something like 5 to 10 acres. And that would be an excellent starting point to work with. And I would say to allow the ground to go fallow for at least one season. And what you're going to do is you're going to allow the weeds to grow that want to grow on that soil, because they're going to do their best to improve it. You want to disc the weeds into the ground, because all of that organic matter needs to go back into the soil. Make sure it is not on the surface, because it will get burned off in a slow oxidative process by the sun. So get that stuff into the ground. So every time the weeds get to be, you consider to be bad, you would want to go out there and disc them back in. And the second thing that you would want to do is to put out about 5 pounds per acre of sugar as often as you can afford. That's different for every farmer. Why would you want to do something like that? The reason why is when you put sugar out, you increase the microbial content tremendously. And the fastest way to get rid of toxins in the soil is through microbes. Why? Because the microbes have the glutathione S-transferase. They have the esterase. They have the P450s. They have all of the equipment necessary in order to break down those toxins. So you want to increase the level of the microbial activity tremendously, almost to an unhealthy degree, and get the microbes cleaning out the soil, because they do not like to be in with all those pesticides, and they will do their part to clean it out. And the fastest way to do that is to throw massive amounts of sugar at the ground. There are some other things that can be done. They're a little bit sometimes more expensive, and if you have deep pockets, you can go that route. But this is usually the simplest and the cheapest thing in order to clean out your soil in as little as one season. Now, you can do it in less than one season, depending upon how toxic the ground is. Once you've started to clean things out and you're disking weeds back in, you can improve the ground tremendously in about 1 year, and you're going to be able to plant on that. So it's not like I'm destroying the farmer's livelihood. He's still going to be able to take care of his family. He's, let's say, got almost 1,000 acres left. He's only putting aside, let's say, 5 acres. But his production on that 5 acres will far exceed that which he is getting on the rest. And this is a process that needs to continue, that is done rather painlessly. There are some individuals who would like to switch over immediately. That's a little more painful. But if you want to do this a little bit slower, you can do so relatively inexpensively. And that is the best way to clean things out. So if you continue to use the pesticides because you feel you have to, then I would choose some high ground necessarily to start with the 5 acres. The reason why is because the runoff. I don't want any pesticides getting on that land that you've just spent time cleaning up. Now, if you let the ground go fallow for 10 years, in almost 100% of the cases, everything will be taken care of, almost 100%. So there have been studies been done on this, and it's relatively well documented, but no farmer wants to let his ground sit for 10 years. And that's why there are ways of cleaning things up quickly. And the fastest way, it's not through chemicals. There's no chemical you can get from Sigma Chemical or any other place that's going to get rid and detoxify those chemicals better than microbes. And so by putting the sugar out, you increase the microbial content so high that you probably wouldn't even want to be putting plants on there. But that's not the idea. The idea is to clean your soil up as quickly as possible. If you can put 5 pounds down a week, that would be ideal because you will clean out the ground very quickly. Some farmers, they've tried to put it up 10 pounds. I don't usually advocate that because I don't want getting a little sticky, and I don't want the nozzles getting all sticky up. But some people have compensated with a little bit more water to put out there. I mean, that's your choice. But if you're putting about 5 pounds of acre, you're going to be in good shape. So if you feel you can up it and your nozzles aren't getting all gunked up, you can go ahead and do that. And that will be the easiest and the fastest way of not only increasing the carbon content of the soil, but getting rid of those toxins. And you will have saved yourself many, many years of trouble, because this is a process that would have happened over time, but you can speed up, considering that sugar goes for, in my supermarket, it's about $1 a pound. So we're not talking about a lot of money here with that. So if you can afford to do $5 a week, then you've simply got the cost of going back and forth over your field that you have to contend with. And I don't think that there's anything faster than that right now. This does go along the line. Some people have suggested cover crops, and that's really very similar to what I am suggesting. The cover crops is allowing things to grow. You can put some, sure, you can put some cover crops out, and they can do their job too. That's also fantastic as well. But the thing with cover crops is there are many different cover crops out there. Some people like to do one. Some people, you know, you've got compaction problems, so you want to use radishes. Down here, we use ryegrass a lot because we don't have compaction problems. But sometimes there's the difficulty of choosing what cover crop you want to do, because the cover crops will also do a very quick job of removing it, but not quite as fast as the sugar. Because when you put out pure sugar, you will see a massive spike in the microbial content that you will never get from a plant, and you will never get from a cover crop. What the plants do is they're releasing between 20 to 70% of their photosynthate back into the soil, depending upon how healthy they are. And it's a slow process. It goes on 24 hours a day, especially at night. So they're introducing the sugar into the soil. But they may have some difficulty doing that as quickly as just giving it a massive dose. And so once the cover crop has taken hold, if you wanted to back off, off of the sugar, then you're going to be in pretty good shape at that point. But make sure that that cover crop is dissed back into the soil, because the mistake is made to essentially lawn mow it, so to speak, where everything is laid out on the surface, because you know they're thinking about soil erosion and things of that sort. But soil erosion will be taken care of. You can have bare soil and have very little soil erosion if you have a high microbial content, because a high microbial content leads to a high fungal content, and the high fungal content brings in glomalin. I was thinking glomeruli because I'm back in my insect laboratory here right now. But the glomalin comes in there, will stick things together. And so you can really prevent soil erosion from occurring by having good, healthy soil. Whereas if it's not cohesive and it's not bonded together through the glomalin or some other things, yes, you can lose the soil quick. But honestly, erosion is not so much of a problem in decades past. It has only recently become a huge issue because we have sterilized the soil. Nothing is holding it together. And anytime wind or water comes along, it is easily picked up. And
Tom, you've mentioned a number of pieces that I want to follow up on. You described the differences a bit between cover crops and just applying sugar direct. And I think this is a fascinating conversation because it's many agronomists agree that it is very important to keep soil covered with green growing plants, and preferably a diversity of green growing plants for an extended period, as much of the year as possible. So yeah. when you look at the mathematics of what you just described, if most plants are contributing 20 to 70% of their photosynthates to the soil profile, isn't that a much larger quantity than 5 pounds of sugar per week? And why would cover crops not have a much bigger impact than the sugar itself?
The cover crops take time in order to grow. So most of the individuals who are putting on the sugar have ground where nothing is growing. So the cover crops, over time, they will catch up, and you are correct. When you have a healthy amount of cover crops, they're going to be putting more sugar, hopefully, assuming their Brix levels are high enough, then they will be putting more sugar into the soil. But for those individuals, I'm sorry, I guess I probably should preface this with some of the farmers that I've had to deal with are dealing with dead soil. So there's the very high electrical conductivity, high salt soils, nothing is growing, not even, you know, foxtail and kochia. And so you've got a situation right now where we need, in order to revitalize the soil, and taking care of the salt problem as well as the pesticide problem can quickly be taken care of because you've got bare ground, and that is by throwing sugar. So the sugar is usually a great way to start. If you are doing the cover crop soon after, that should be able to catch up relatively quickly, especially depending upon the cover crop. And if you've got a variety, that's better than using one cover crop. There are some advantages to doing just one, and this has to do with machines. You know, it's easier to go over something if it's the same cover crop rather than having a variety. But if you've got the capabilities of taking pretty much any of the cover crops and throwing them back into the soil, whether it be through disking or some other means, then not only will you have the sugar being thrown into the plant by the cover crops, but you will also have the organic matter, the carbon, under the soil too, which will be broken down by the microbes and will then add considerably to the carbon sequestration of the soil. So excellent point. You're right. There are various situations that would call more for the cover crops than they would the sugar. So I probably should have prefaced it with the type of soil that you might be dealing with if you're putting out sugar on a weekly basis.
Thanks for clarifying that. You mentioned that erosion has become a much bigger challenge recently as compared to historically. Why do you believe that is the case?
Well, I think I just mentioned it, and that's because the microbes are gone. So because the microbes are gone, you have fluffy soil that is easily washed away, whereas when the microbes are in there, they are dying all the time. So microbes are dying, and when they die, their membrane breaks, and you've got, you know, liquid goo comes out of their system. So you're having millions upon millions upon millions of microbes dying every second in your soil, and that in and of itself is a type of goo which helps keep the soil together. So if you sterilize the soil, I mean, just imagine putting it under a heat lamp and sterilizing it so that you've got nothing in there right now. It is very easy in order to wash that away. You're going to have no moisture. You're going to have no microbes. And you can blow on that type of soil or sand, and it will easily get blown away. Or you can put some water on it, and it will easily get washed away. And this is a situation that was not as serious in decades past that has become more serious because with the advent of the pesticides, which have helped to sterilize the soil and make it far easier in order for soil to be picked up and deposited somewhere else.
Got it. What has been something that you puzzled over for a long time?
would this be agricultural for, I mean, am I talking to farmers right now, or are we talking about science? And
we're talking about science. We're talking to, I should have perhaps clarified at the beginning, but we're talking to agronomists and extremely knowledgeable farmers, citizen scientists.
Okay. I guess that would be my own research. I don't want to get too much into this because I might get off the beaten path, but we have puzzled for over 20 years how insects smell. And so this is something which has been a big issue for me. We knew that they were smelling electromagnetically, but we did not know the process and how it was occurring. And so when I say puzzled over it, I mean, this is probably at least 10 years, pushing 15, where I was unable to put the pieces of the puzzle together. And so this is really my bread and butter here in the laboratory, is to understand how insects smell. And even though we knew it was electromagnetic, process was not well worked out. So in consulting and understanding how photosynthesis and rhodopsin and some other proteins work about absorbing energy, to understand how ultraviolet energy is absorbed by certain amino acids, and understanding how this process occurs, it has helped me to understand how insects are actually smelling. And as of November of 2016, we were able to decipher the insect olfactory code. So as of a year and a half ago, we were finally able to figure out what the insects were doing, to understand what frequencies were involved and how to determine something like this. And therefore, new puzzlements have come. So even though we finally, practically my entire professional life is to figure out how they're doing that, now that we've got the system down, it's a matter of taking a look and going through and working out the details. In other words, understanding not just how insects smell carbon dioxide, but to explain to you why carbon dioxide is detected differently among Culex mosquitoes, Anopheles mosquitoes, Aedes mosquitoes, so on and so forth, why bed bugs smell carbon dioxide differently, why kissing bugs smell it differently, to understand why some Lepidoptera, butterflies, and moths do so. And it's really getting into the details right now of, yes, we understand how they're doing it, but now we understand that each insect is smelling differently, which has helped bring up new puzzlements, if I may use that word again, in it. So that's been the big one. So we were happy to solve it, but it was a source of contention for a long time in our laboratory.
This is a fascinating piece, Tom, and I know that this is something that many growers are very interested in and would love to understand much better. Would you be willing and able to dig a little bit deeper into describing how the olfactory senses work and why some insects are attracted to certain regions where others are not?
I would not be able to discuss with you too many of the details because it is proprietary information. So what I'd be happy to do is discuss in generality, if I could.
Please.
The insects are smelling with their antenna and with their palps, which are some of the mouth parts. So when they're flying through the air, they pick up various odorants in the air, and these odorants are vibrating and giving off energy. They're absorbing and emitting energy constant. As long as they're above 0 degrees Kelvin, which is absolute zero, they are vibrating, and these electromagnetic vibrations can be easily detected by various equipment in the laboratory as well as the equipment on an insect. So they have various scintilla, I would call them tiny antenna, on the actual antenna proper of the insect. And it's these antenna, whether it be the antenna proper or whether it be the smaller scintilla on the insect, which are tuned in to very particular frequencies. And these particular frequencies are all important for the particular insect. So some insects would not be tuned into CO2. They would have no reason to, whereas other insects like mosquitoes would be tuned into CO2. There are certain floral compounds given off by plants that some insects are going to be attracted to, honeybees being prominent among them. And then you have certain scents that are not attractive at all because some insects don't go after flowers. Extending what I'm talking about right now, there are some plants that advertise themselves as unhealthy. And when they do so, they are picked up by other insects. And so insects are only tuned in to the unhealthy plant. No insect will ever attack a healthy plant. So what they're zooming in on is the unhealthy plant because it's digestible. Healthy plants are not digestible. Unhealthy plants are. So because they can't digest a healthy plant, there's no interest in even attacking it. So it either has to be injured or it has to be unhealthy. And then by doing so, it is now digestible. And this is what an insect is going to attack. So beginning of the conversation, I mentioned, you know, how insects are, once you get above above 12 bricks really aren't causing any more issues with your plants. And once you get above 14, they're really not even landing on your plant, except if they just want to rest on it, because they won't be able to take a bite. Or if they do take a bite, they either won't be able to get through the plant cuticle, or if they do take a bite or even get in the phloem tissue, it's not going to be digestible to them, and they'll have to pull out and move on to a different source. So all insects are flying above looking for crop plants that are digestible to them, and they advertise themselves. Plants advertise themselves as being unhealthy, essentially saying, I'm unhealthy, please come eat me. And so the insect will come in and it will start eating the plant, because that's the job. Our job is to eat healthy plants. We have a much more elaborate enzyme system. Our digestive systems are designed in order to eat healthy food. We don't do well eating Doritos all the time. We do well eating healthy plants, and this leads us to be healthy. For the insect, it's different. The insects do not do well on healthy plants. They can starve on a healthy. You can take a Colorado potato beetle and put it on a healthy potato plant, and it will not be able to eat it. But you can take an unhealthy potato plant, and the Colorado potato beetle will go to town, because this is what it is meant to do. And so because insects are only attracted to unhealthy plants, the unhealthy plants will advertise themselves. They've got certain visible frequencies that they can detect, especially from a distance, and they've got certain odors, and these odors can be picked up by the antenna and by the cilia, and the insect will move in for the kill, so to speak.
What are some of, when we look at plant health, you're talking about healthy plants versus unhealthy plants, what are some of the compounds that serve as insect attractants that we could manage and monitor?
You can.
In general?
Yeah, in general, it would really have to be a general thing. Generally speaking, ethanol is a universal odorant that advertises itself as being unhealthy. So a lot of the plants will release not just ethanol, but also various alcohol components. Not all alcohols, but a lot of alcohols advertise a plant as being unhealthy, which is a hallmark of fermentation. Fermentation produces the alcohol. So when a plant is degrading and it's in trouble and it's fermenting, even in a small way, even in an imperceptible way, it is, you know, going to be fermenting in its own way, and therefore it will advertise itself. So if these odorants are being released, they will be picked up by insects. It will change how the plants are perceived. So you can take satellite images of two crop plants, and they look different on various images. It can be a visible image, or it can be an infrared image, but they both may be corn. They both may be soybean. They both may be anything you could think of, but they will not have the same look under an infrared camera or under a visible camera. And this is another way that the plant would use in order to say, oh, this is an unhealthy plant. I will fly down and I will start eating. This is something which is very profound in the grasshoppers. So the locust swarms that you will find, you don't find them so much in the United States, but in other continents, the locust swarms are a problem. And it's really quite remarkable, because these locust swarms, not just millions of individuals, but billions, sometimes trillions of individuals, will descend upon a very particular crop and take it all the way down to the roots, and then pick up and fly away. And they will leave a farmer's field right next to that exempt. And these are the remarkable things that you realize when you see stuff like this. Oh, the grasshopper made a decision. It made a decision to eat one plant over another. Why? Why didn't it just come down and eat everything? We've always been told that grasshoppers will eat anything. And yet here was, you know, direct proof and some of the images that I have seen and testimonies of others is that no, they actually are very selective. Now, I should tell you that grasshoppers are less selective than other insects. Some insects will disappear by about bricks of 8. Other insects, they will continue to chew on your plants right up through 10, 11, 12 bricks. And once they get to about 12, they will lose interest. And the grasshoppers are among them. So you can find the grasshoppers among slightly healthier plants for that reason. But you're going to find the aphid, the leafhoppers, some of the other homopterous insects. Once they get to 8, the plant gets to 8, they lose interest in the plant. And you just won't find insects on a plant above 8 if it's a homopterous insect. And those are the ones that have the beak that they stick into the phloem tissue and take a sip from the sugar water that is flowing around the phloem tissue. So every insect has its own cutoff. And so you really have a lot of insects fall off by the time you get to 8. And as I mentioned at the beginning of this, you know, most of the crops are between 4 to 8. So a lot of plants are really susceptible to every single insect that is out there. But if you can get above 8, you pretty much can take care of your aphids and your leaf hoppers and psyllids, the Asian citrus psyllid down here in Florida and others, because it's very rare to find a citrus tree that's above 8. We've tested a lot of them. And so once you move up the scale, other insects fall off at 9, 10, 11, 12. And at that point, insects really lose interest once you get above 12. And as I said, 14 is your safe zone. That's a relatively safe zone that you don't have to worry about. But 12, you know, a plant can dip down and can easily go 10 or 11 on the brick scale on certain circumstances. And this is some of the variety that you were mentioning before, is that, yeah, sometimes it's a little difficult to predict bricks because there are conditions which allow it. They're all sending messages. And as a scientist, I like to decipher these codes to try and understand what plant is telling us when it was at a bricks of 10 one day, and the next day it goes down to 3. And there are very specific reasons as to why a plant would do something like that. So if you're going to ask, and this may be on your mind right now, John, so I'll just answer the question for you. But down here, we have something called storms. I know the storms are not as common in the rest of the country, but down here in Florida, we have storms all of the time. And so plants, you know, in a very gentle, freak-out sort of fashion, when a storm comes in, a big storm, they shunt all of the sugar down into the roots. And so you could have drastic drops in bricks levels. When I talk about bricks, I'm talking about leaf bricks. You could have drastic drops in leaf bricks. We have tested plants that looked healthy to us. They looked healthy, like, oh, this looks like a healthy plant, relatively green leaf, and we'll test it right before a storm, and it comes in at 1 to 3 bricks. 1 to 3. I mean, it's based upon readings like that, and we've even gotten to the 10th. I've gotten 1.1, 1.3, and you think to yourself, how is this plant even surviving? Well, it's just a temporary thing, because when a major storm comes in, if the top of the plant is lost, the sugar that's in the roots will allow the plant to regrow again once the danger has passed. And we've detected leaves in, let's say, the 1 to 3 bricks range, but then we have to go deep and we pull out some of the roots, and they're coming in at 14 bricks. Not because the roots are normally at 14 bricks, but simply because it's just a temporary shunting of the sugar around the plant. And see, these are little clues that help you to understand bricks a little bit better. So these exceptions, I mean, over time, and again, it's probably because I'm a scientist, I'd like to take a look at the exceptions to understand it, because people will come up and say, well, I found some psyllids on my citrus plant or some leafhoppers here, and we tested it, and the plants were coming in at 9. So I don't see what the problem is. Well, you have, the plant is never at a uniform, let's say, 9 bricks. There are certain regions of the plant that are going to be a little bit lower than others, and those are the ones that will get attacked. So with the case of citrus greening, for example, it happens to be one of those diseases that, I call it a plug disease for simplistic sake. A plug meaning it forms a plug, it's a carbohydrate plug, and it prevents nutrients from passing into a particular branch, which causes the branch to go down in bricks. And so therefore that branch will become susceptible. So it will advertise itself. The Asian citrus psyllid will come in and some others will come in. And because of this, that branch will be affected, but the tree may be a little bit healthier due to the plug, because things are not flowing around the plant the way that they should be. And so these are the cases that you run into, is you could have certain parts of the tree or even a branch which have a temporary unhealthy aspect, which can bring in the insect. And these are all the exceptions. And I realize that I'm, you know, by talking about the exceptions, I'm not talking about the reason, the real reason why you do bricks. This may be causing some confusion among some of my listeners, but by understanding, one, the generalities of bricks, and then understanding all the exceptions helps you to understand what's going on with the plant, and has allowed scientists like me to understand what game the plants are playing and why.
When we use sap analysis with many of the farmers that we are working with, one of the fractions that are measured, some of the pieces that are measured on a sap analysis, are we are looking at different parts of the nitrogen profile. So we're looking at the total nitrogen in the plant, and also looking at the nitrate nitrogen and the ammonium nitrogen. And we've observed through field experience a correlation between elevated concentrations of, say, nitrate or ammonium to specific groups of insects. Are those compounds serving as insect attractants based on what you've been describing?
I would say indirectly, yes. The reason why is because when you say attractant, usually you smell something and then you go to it. And that's kind of how attractants work. Whereas the high nitrogen that you're referring to right now is not what I would consider to be an attractant. And that is nitrogen molecules are not emanating from the plant and being picked up. So it would not qualify as an attractant. But what is going on is you have an imbalance in the plant. It's a physiological imbalance in the plant, which causes the nitrogen to be shunted in between one form and another, which can be a healthy form or an unhealthy form or a reproductive form or a vegetative form. The reason I'm getting, you know, a little bit complicated, and I don't want to cloud the picture that I'm saying, but when you have these conditions going on in the plant, that's a way that the plant is now advertising itself as unhealthy, and it can do so almost directly in the electromagnetic spectrum. I mean, there will be visible frequencies or infrared frequencies that will be picked up immediately by insects because the plant is stressed. What do I mean by that? So for example, if you have a plant that's suffering, I mean, you look at it, you know, you look at it, I look at it, we can see, okay, this plant needs a little bit of help. And let's just say for the sake of argument, we put down a nitrogenous fertilizer, a classic NPK that you get in most of the stores. So we have a quick bloom. The plant greens up, everything kind of looks good, and it looks like the plant has just gotten healthy. And to a certain extent, it has. But what you've done is you've stressed out plant because nitrogenous fertilizers are salt-based. It's a force-feeding operation that goes on with the plant. The plant is not really feeding itself. You put the salt-based fertilizer down, it increases the conductivity, forces the nutrients into the plant, causes a quick burst of growth, but all along the plant is stressed, and the insects know that, and the insects know that. So you can have a case, for example, of if you have a plant, grass is a good one, but there are other grassy type of plants, monocots, that kind of fall into the same situation, is that if they start to go through drought conditions, so the water levels are going down, and you see the plant is starting to suffer. Many individuals say, I can see the plant's in trouble right now, I need to feed it, not thinking necessarily that it probably needs water because of the drought conditions, but that it needs something else. So you will put down a nitrogenous fertilizer in order to green things up. And so what this does, it is very, very attractive to the chinch bug. So Blissus leucopterus, the chinch bug, is very attracted to those situations. One, drought condition. Two, high nitrogen. So when you have that combination, you're going to bring in the chinch bug because this is what it likes. You will notice down here and elsewhere too that the chinch bug does not attack grass indiscriminately. It has to attack grass under very specific circumstances. So it's not just about the drought, nor is it just about putting down a nitrogenous fertilizer and throwing excess nitrogen into the plant. The plant, the insect is looking for a very specific combination because the type of stress plant that it's looking to eat is going to be more easily digestible under certain circumstances. And so even though, you know, 1 million insects have not been deciphered, we understand, you know, how some insects work and why some insects are attracted to some unhealthy plants and other insects are attracted to other unhealthy plants. Citrus down here, for example, we have multiple insects that are attacking the citrus, but you usually don't find, you know, all of them. You don't find the citrus leaf miner, nor do you find the Asian citrus psyllid, nor do you find some of the notchers, the leaf notchers down here, all feeding on exactly the same plant and exactly the same population level. Instead, you'll find the Asian citrus psyllid focused in one area, the leaf notcher is located in another, and the citrus leaf miner on another. And these are all clues that give you an idea that, yes, the plant is unhealthy. That's a universal constant, but that the conditions are different for each insect because each insect has its role in eating that which is digestible to it. The citrus leaf miner is inside the leaf. The Asian citrus psyllid is going after the phloem tissue. The leaf notchers, some of them are going after the roots. They'll go ahead and take a bite of the leaf, but they've all got different parts of the plant, and the plant has to be a certain state of unhealthiness in order to be attacked. And so this is why the generality of bricks have been kind of lost on a lot of people. I kind of got that a little bit from you at the beginning, is that, you know, bricks is a little difficult to decipher. I'm not sure if it's really given me the answers that I want. And that is because it really is more complex than we think. Because I know in the past, everyone has said bricks of 12, bricks of 12. Get to a bricks of 12, the insects stop. And that's not absolutely true. I have seen insects take a bite of a plant above 12 bricks. It will not stay and feed, but it will take a bite from it. And so this looks like a contradiction, but it's not really. And so to understand what really is going on with the bricks and using that as an idea to understand what the insects are doing allows you to make these connections, which again will go ahead and help the farmer. Because I can go out, take a look to see what insect is attacking a plant and give you a pretty good idea what the bricks is going to be before I even test it.
Earlier, you mentioned just in general some of the compounds that plants are releasing and also the signals that these compounds are transmitting.
Yes.
At various distances. And I know we're speaking in very high-level generalizations, but in general, what are the possible detection distances for some of these compounds that serve as insect signaling mechanisms?
Oh my gosh, the same as any other odorant. It actually doesn't really differ at all, John. So it doesn't matter whether it's 10 yards away or whether it's a mile away. Any of these odorants, you know, can be detected from great distances. So as long as an odorant is able to get blown away by the wind and an insect can smell it, they will then follow the scent of that odorant to its source. And so the distances can be tremendous. As far as the electromagnetic, that really depends upon, you know, and the electromagnetic component. So that would be the compound eye. How far can the insect see? Grasshoppers are flying pretty high up in the atmosphere. So when they're looking down, they're not looking at individual plants like a lot of insects would. They're looking at, they see what we see when we see satellite images. They see a bunch of squares, rectangles, and trapezoids. I mean, that's really what they see. And when they see a trapezoid that looks attractive, they will descend upon that trapezoid and that plant that they will consume because it's sending off a general electromagnetic visual type of message, because the odorants are generally not getting up into the atmosphere when a locust swarm passes by unless they're flying low enough. But a lot of them are flying pretty high. Other insects, yes, they will key in on a very specific plant. And even sometimes more specific than that, they will key in on the part of the plant that is suffering. Like I said, a branch that may be dying, that's where the insects will congregate if they're going to start eating that particular plant, whatever that plant will happen to be. So the distance is not really that important. They're going to be able to detect it no matter where they are, just as they would any other odorant that comes out there.
So perhaps a non-agriculture related question. I have friends who will attract every mosquito for dozens of yards around, and other friends who are, for all practical purposes, mosquito immune. Can you describe the differences?
I hate doing this because you're recording it right now. But that is the difference between healthy people and unhealthy people. So if you have digestible blood, the insect can use your blood. If you have healthy blood, the insect is not as attracted to it. Does this mean you're healthy all the time? No. People have certain states of healthiness and unhealthiness. But as long as your blood is digestible, it's going to be attractive to an insect. And so human beings advertise themselves as being more digestible from the standpoint of the blood, because it goes with what I talked about before. It's the digestive system. Insects do not have very good digestive system. Stuff has to come in digested to them because they cannot digest things. They just don't have the enzymes. They're garbage collectors. They eat muck. They eat garbage. They eat bad stuff. They eat stuff that we don't want to eat. Take a look at cockroaches, for example. There are many other examples. Fruit flies, they're always around decaying fruit. They're not around healthy fruit. And so you've got these insects that are keying in on very specific plants, or even, let's say, the fruiting structures like a tomato, and that's what they are keying in on. So the mosquitoes need something that's digestible. So when they take a blood meal, it must be incorporated through the process of vitellogenesis. Take those nutrients in your blood and incorporate them into an egg. And this occurs in about 24 hours. So it's all done very, very quickly. So if they're not getting digestible blood, they cannot, through the process of vitellogenesis, take those nutrients and feed their eggs. And that's a problem, because obviously the mosquito wants to feed its egg. That's the only reason it takes a blood meal, is to feed its eggs. And so we do have these differences of individuals, and some are just more digestible than others, and they're going to be more attractive. You can force, you know, an insect to take a blood meal, but they can do better, and therefore they have a choice. What I talked about before with the grasshoppers, they'll have a choice as to what crop they eat, and the mosquitoes have a choice as to what blood meal they wish to get. And so through their antenna and all of their senses, they detect that some one is more digestible than another, and they're going to go after that individual. And that's exactly what's happening. And even though I may be offending some people out there right now, I do feel an obligation in order to tell the truth the way that I know it, according to the information that has been given to me for the past 20 to 30 years of my life studying insects.
I very much doubt that you're offending people. I would say much more you're communicating some very intriguing ideas that are based on many of us have observed these things to be true in real life and have wondered about the differences. So thanks for sharing that.
Oh, happy to do so. It's like when you go inside a supermarket, when you see fruit flies flying around the tomatoes, some people think, oh, I want to grab these tomatoes. They got fruit flies in them. But honestly, all you got to do is search and you will find that one tomato, maybe near the bottom, that is injured. And that's the one where all the fruit flies are located. So everyone, I think, instinctively knows this who has ever bought a tomato in a supermarket before. You've seen the fruit flies. You kind of get how the process goes, but you just kind of have to put two and two together and realize, oh, yeah, the fruit fly is not attacking all the tomatoes. It's only going after the ones that are unhealthy. And that essentially equates to that which is digestible. So a tomato that is degrading, that is decomposing, is being broken down. And when it's being broken down, it's digestible. That goes back to what I was saying. Insects will only eat that which is digestible to their system.
Quite some time ago, Tom, we had a conversation, you and I, where we were talking about environment determines genetic expression and the idea of the genetics. And you expressed that you have had difficulties infecting some mosquitoes with malaria. And so just as we're having this conversation about mosquitoes, that popped back into my mind once more. What are the differences between healthy and unhealthy mosquitoes as vectors of bacterial agent?
Okay. Well, I specifically have not infected mosquitoes with malaria. So let me just make that clear right now. It wasn't me. It was through talking to researchers and understanding the diseases out there is that many insects, let me put it this way. Most Anopheles mosquitoes do not transmit malaria. Most Aedes mosquitoes do not transmit dengue, yellow fever, or Zika. Most Culex mosquitoes do not transmit encephalitis. And that then goes back to what we were talking about before is, you know, when you see this observation, you understand that not all insects are infected with the disease. So you can get, you know, bitten by thousands and thousands of Anopheles mosquitoes and not get malaria. But all you have to do is get bit by one mosquito that does have malaria in order for you to get it. And this is one of the truths of biology that has been revealed to us. And that is that insects also have various states of health and unhealth. In order for them to be relatively healthy, they need digested components. I've talked about that. Their food source need to be as such. But if their food source is not that good, if it's missing something, they can suffer. Insects have died in the field. I've seen it many times. Sometimes people try to keep them as pets. And they die. We see them dying in the field all the time. So insects die. They are susceptible to disease. And so they also have states of health and unhealth that are, you know, somewhat analogous to what you would find in a human. And they are more susceptible at that point. So when you have a disease, and if you're working with mosquitoes in the laboratory, and you try and infect them with the particular disease that they're supposed to be infected with, Anopheles mosquitoes with malaria, for example, you will not get a 100% infection rate. And that is kind of amazing. And that is in part because, you know, when you're raising them in the laboratory, they're cuddled, they're given everything that they need, and so therefore they're in pretty good shape, and it becomes a little difficult in order to infect them. So out in the field, they might be more susceptible. Ones that are more susceptible might die. Others would be more susceptible to actually getting a disease, like say the malaria protozoan or the Zika virus or anything of that sort, and it can actually take hold of the system because the insect is unable to doesn't have the immune system in order to take care of it. So therefore, it kind of sets up shop inside the insect. So this is kind of briefly what we were discussing in that conversation to which you refer, is that not even all insects have diseases. I mean, most humans are mostly healthy most of the time, and that's actually kind of relatively true of insects as well. And I would guess, you know, speaking as an entomologist, it's probably true for most animals and plants.
Intriguing. Absolutely intriguing. In all the various research and different things that you've looked at through your very rich career, what has been something that really surprised you?
Something that really surprised me? I guess the first thing that comes to mind is that which is recent, and I kind of alluded to it before, simply because it's a focus of my research now, and that is after we decipher the insect olfactory code, there are a massive number of details to be worked out. And so the thing which I've talked about a lot over the past few months to my laboratory mates and others too is how different insects are smelling the same molecule. That is something which is kind of forefront on my mind right now as I'm, you know, conducting this interview. So if I had to go back in my past, it might take me a little longer to come up with something, and maybe it would be more intriguing than what I'm telling you right now. But as of right now, that is on my mind, and I'm amazed at how, as a matter of fact, while I'm giving this interview, I'm looking at frequencies right now for the Indian meal moth on my desk, and taking a look at the frequencies and understanding how they're smelling, how they're picking up the pheromone, and seeing the differences between the various odor receptors, gustatory receptors, ionotropic receptors, things of that sort, and putting this stuff together into a cohesive smell is something that has kind of taken me off guard. I was kind of the impression, certainly 20 years ago, is that when you smelled an odorant, we had a receptor. That's kind of the way I looked at it. We had a receptor, and this receptor responded to this particular smell. Now, we know differently. We know, just for example, and this is common knowledge, is that there are between 2 to 3 CO2 receptors for insects. They don't have one receptor for carbon dioxide. They have 2 to 3 receptors for carbon dioxide. And I would go so far as to say they have more, but I won't go any further than what I just said. And so when you take a look at this and you see, wow, this is amazing. I mean, there's a complexity about it, but there's also a simplicity too. It is more complex because it wasn't what I thought, but it's simplistic because then I see when you put all this stuff together and I think, wow, this just kind of gives you a window into what God has done. And you understand that you don't know anything where you think you did. I mean, 20 years ago when I started the laboratory and I graduated, I mean, I had the big bad PhD. So you kind of sort of think at that point that you know quite a bit. And now I can absolutely tell you how little I know. I could not tell you how little I knew 20 years ago, but I can tell you exactly how little I know now. And so these are some of the surprises that have come up to me, is that it's not what I expected. And because it's not what I expected, I just kind of have to follow the evidence. Being a scientist, you have to follow the evidence. You follow reason as far as your mind has allowed you. This is what has been given to us. So we scientists are able to reason through things. Every human being is meant to reason. We are obligated to do so in the scientific world. And then taking scientific evidence and then applying reason to it in order to rationally wade through the muck, which is all of the knowledge that we don't know. And so finding out these things has been an absolute joy. And this is part of the joy of being a scientist. This is part of the joy of being in a laboratory and coming up with new things. And this is also part of the joy of not only giving interviews like this, but speaking to groups at conferences and divulging some more of this information so that you can bring the wonder of science, the wonder of insects, or even the wonder of insect olfaction to people who've never had a chance to think about it before.
Absolutely. We live in an incredibly beautiful world if we take the chance to observe it. What you're describing is really fascinating for me, because what you're describing in essence is that every insect can be in the precise same environment, but they perceive their environment differently from an olfactory perspective, which basically means that they're smelling things differently, which is really intriguing because we've known that to be true for various organisms from a visual and auditory perspective, but particularly I would say from a visual perspective, in that different organisms can look at something, but they perceive different wavelengths, and so they see a different image. And what you're describing, in essence, if I'm understanding it correctly, is that they are also perceiving their environment differently from an olfactory perspective as well.
They are. Yep.
That is fascinating. What do you believe to be true about modern agriculture that many other people don't believe to be true?
What do I perceive to be true? Wow, that's a loaded question. I'm not sure if I got an answer which comes to the top of my mind immediately. Because honestly, a lot of the things that I think are important, I think a lot of people know about. So if I told you, something that I know about agriculture, I can almost guarantee you already know about it, John, because I know you. So what do I know that maybe you don't know or someone else doesn't know? I'm not sure if I do, to be honest with you.
Let me rephrase the question a little bit. What do you believe to be true that a tomato grower in California doesn't believe to be true?
Okay. Well, let me talk about something that I talked about already. And this is summed up in one sentence. Insects are only attracted to unhealthy plants. Yeah, this has become like my most popular talk. You just get shock from people. I mean, you have spoken heresy. So even though, I mean, I know where you stand on this, John, and I understand many other people do agree with this philosophy, and I get that, but it still causes shock. when I give this presentation. It still does. And it's one of the opening slides that I do. And I said, look, if I'm going to say a heretical comment, I'm going to make it right now. But then I go through and I back up why I say what I say. I've talked a little bit about that right now, but that's really the big shocker. So if I had to limit myself to agriculture, I would say that insects are only attracted to unhealthy plants. Because if you believe that, and I'm sure most of my listeners do not, because I've seen the looks on the crowds that I've spoken to, if you do believe that, your whole thinking changes on insects. Suddenly, you have no use for insecticides. I mean, it just follows with that level of thinking, because you realize, well, insects, I'm not competing with them then. They're just eating some of the garbage plants that I shouldn't be eating. So I really don't need to spray them anymore. So now are the organophosphates and synthetic pyrethroids and carbamates and neonicotinoids, they're all kind of unnecessary. And that's the you know, as you reason through this, that's one of the conclusions that you come to. You have to come to it when you believe that insects are only attracted to unhealthy plants. It's not just that statement that stands alone. It's that statement, and then you have extensions coming off of that statement, which help to explain things that people might not have considered before. So I don't even have to come out as some sort of anti-pesticidal guy. I can simply say insects are not attracted to unhealthy plants. And by extension, I would say, yes, insecticides are unnecessary. They're just unnecessary as a whole. Under specific circumstances, they have their role, because I will be the first to admit to you, you know, I've had fire ants. Sometimes they come into the house. I do have a raid can in my house, and we have had situations where the kids, you know, would leave food crumbs around, and, you know, the situation has to be taken care of. So I'm not afraid to use insecticides, and I understand that they have their place. However, having said that, when I'm raising crops, and I do plant some stuff in my garden at my house, I'm never, ever spraying it with anything. I'm not putting, well, I mean, not pesticides. I have no insecticides. I don't have knowledge of all the insecticides, but I don't use any of them. I'm not using any herbicides or fungicides. I'm just not going that route. And that's just what comes that with that knowledge of that insects are only attracted to unhealthy plants, is they're not my enemy, and I use them as indicators. So I go out and I would check my corn plants, for example, and I would look to see if it's being attacked. And if it is, what insect is attacking it? And therefore come to a conclusion as to something maybe that I forgot on a particular. So, for example, the first time I started planting corn, I did have a few insects that were attacking it. By the time I got to the third time that I was planting corn, no insects were attacking it, but I suspect deer came in and cleaned me out. And this is the difference between the insect digestive system and the mammalian digestive system, is we have a higher level digestive system. We can handle healthy food. So the deer are more interested in healthy crop. They're not going to go after unhealthy stuff. They'll leave that up to the insects. But if you do have a healthy crop, you got to watch out for the deer, because the deer came in and I think one night, maybe two nights, and I don't know how many of them came through. They cleaned out about 140. I had about 140 corn plants that I had planted for the benefit of my family, and I lost 99% of ears on it overnight. So these are the things that I think, I mean, in a sense, I'd like to pat myself on the back and think, okay, well, at least the insects didn't get it. I'm an entomologist. That would have been embarrassing. But the deer sideswiped me and cleaned me out. And so these are the things that you kind of learn as you're not only planting stuff, but also observing, as you need to go out and take a look at your crop plants, understand what's going on, and that will give you clues as to what is going on, and therefore give you an idea as to what you need to do in order to take care of the problem. And there are many different ways of taking care of all of the problems that farmers run into when planting crops.
What is a book or a resource that you recommend most often to growers?
I haven't recommended a book or a resource to a grower in a long time, to be honest with you. So there are a number of books that I have read. I look at them more as academic than anything else. I guess I haven't read the type of books that should be read by the farmers. I mean, I keep myself always looking for the cutting edge type of thing. I'm not looking at necessarily like picking up a book on how to raise tomatoes or something like that. I'm looking for something ridiculously complex, because this is just, you know, the problem that I've had and I've always had. It's a birth defect, is that we scientists, we like to make things more complex than they actually are. And this is something that I haven't been able to shake. So because of that, I probably am not well read enough in order to recommend a book, a publication, or anything like that in order to help a farmer. One of the things that I really love to do, and this interview is part of it, is to actually just go out there and talk. So to talk to the farmers directly. So it's I like it when it's not filtered. I like it when I go and I talk to 100 to 1,000 farmers at once. I get a high from that type of thing because I can talk to them directly about their crop plants. Sometimes you need to talk one-on-one with them after the presentation is over when they kind of see where you're at. And those are the things that I like rather than just kind of giving them a cookbook as to what they need to do, which is usually what you find in a book. I prefer to actually talk to them directly because each one has their own story to tell and their own problem as well. So that's a long roundabout way of saying I'm just not able to answer your question, John, but good question nonetheless.
Great. What is the question you wish I would have asked or that you would have liked to talk about?
No. I think you asked some great questions right there. I mean, we touched upon probably the most important one, and that is insects are really attracted to unhealthy plants and all of the extensions that come from that, which we've touched upon some of them, and I touch upon more in a more formal presentation. Those are the type of things I think if you can get something like that out, you change the mindset of everyone. People are no longer planting crops the same way that they did before. And that is to disseminate information, is to talk to them about energy systems so that they understand how to raise a high energy crop. Talk to them about insects so that they understand that all of them are indicators. They indicate to you what's going on with the plant. They're not something to be fought against because this is the consensus, not only in the scientific world, but among secular society as well, too, is that this is something that we just need to consign ourselves to do, is to try and beat down the insects. But if we take a look at that, the whole mindset changes, and I love seeing that change in the mindset way when people start thinking of ways of things in a very different way than they had done before, and then their mind starts to go in that direction and they start bringing up points that are just pure genius because they're immediately able to apply it to their crop. They understand, oh yeah, I mean, I was out the other day in a certain part of my field which was being attacked, and I was in another part of the field and nothing was being attacked right there, and this is making so much sense. They start putting things together and then they become a better farmer. And when you get better farmers, you get better food. And when you get better food, you get a healthier society. And when you have a healthier society, there's just no stopping a good, healthy society. So let's continue to eat well and continue to educate the farmers, which I so enjoy doing, so that they can continue to give us good food, not only for myself, for my wife, but for my children as well.
Absolutely. Tom, this has been a fascinating conversation. Thank you so much for joining us for this episode, and I look forward to having you back on the podcast in the future. Thank you very much. We've been very honored to have you here.
That would be fine. I enjoyed it too, John, and thank you so much for the opportunity.
Thanks, Tom.
This podcast was brought to you by a great company that I work for, Advancing Eco-Agriculture, the leader in regenerative agriculture since 2006. At AEA, we believe in challenging the status quo to find more profitable and regenerative ways to grow crops. We also believe that healthy plants are resistant to pests and disease, and that to grow healthy plants, we must first think differently about agriculture, about empowering life instead of suppressing life, about regeneration versus degeneration. To achieve this, we formulate and sell products that help growers produce higher quality yield with less risk of crop failure. In short, we help growers make more money with less risk. If you aren't yet an AEA customer, go to advancingecoag.com and use the code REGENERATE5 for 5% off your first order. Thank you for listening.